When 19-year-old Johnny Agar finished his 5K race, he had many people, including family and friends, supporting him at the end. See, Johnny has cerebral palsy, which makes physical difficulty extremely difficult. Activity for him is almost impossible at times, but he and his dad, Jeff, have teamed up together to compete in many 5K races, obviously his dad pushing and Johnny riding. But in the midst of one of the great races, Johnny said, "I want to finish, Dad, all by myself." And so halfway through the race, his dad stopped and took Johnny out of the cart, helped him to his walker, and he made it all the way to the end on his own 2 feet. As you might imagine, when he crossed the finish line, it was a major celebration. Family and friends were shouting and cheering. And as a result of that, he was asked by newspaper reporters, "How did this go for you today, Johnny?" And here's what he said. "It made it so much easier for me to run the race knowing I had all these people standing behind me. It was their encouragement that drove me on." Actress Celeste Holmes said, "We live by encouragement or we die slowly, sadly, and angrily without it." Every single one of us today find it important to feel lifted up and loved. We find it imperative that we fellowship on a regular basis with folks who can fuel our happiness and hope and infuse us with an incredible sense of joy. And by far the most uplifting letter of the Bible, hands down, in the pages of God's Word, is just this little epistle that was penned by Paul to a group of preferred people that he deeply loved in a little hamlet called Philippi. It centers on this subject of joy. In fact, you'll find the words joy and rejoice 18 times in 4 chapters. Let me give you an example from each chapter. Look at chapter 1 and verse 4. "Always offering prayer with what? Joy in my every prayer." And then look at chapter 2 and verse 2. "Make my" what? "Joy complete." And then in chapter 3 and verse 1. "Finally, my brethren," there it is, "rejoice in the Lord." Chapter 4 and verse 4. "Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice." It splashed all over the pages of this epistle. And you might be thinking, well, Paul is happy because life is turning out well for him. Absolutely not. It may shock you to know that this little letter of joy was penned from a prison. It was penned from a jailhouse cell. Paul was in Rome awaiting trial and an uncertain future when he sat down and wrote this little letter. And it tells me that we can be happy even when we're going through the hardest times possible in life. Now, let me offer you my outline for the letter of Philippians. It tells us where we're going to be going in the next few months. It's all about joy. First, we see joy in the struggles of life. Chapter 1, verses 12 to 14. "Oh, brethren, I want you to know my circumstances," that's an imprisonment, "have turned out for the greater progress of the gospel, so that my imprisonment in the cause of Christ has become well known throughout the whole Praetorian Guard and to everyone else, and that most of the brothers trusting in the Lord because of my imprisonment have far more courage to speak the word of God without fear." So Paul said, "I'm experiencing joy in the struggles of life." Chapter 2, the theme is joy in the sacrificial life. And he will give us the example of Christ, the ultimate sacrifice, in chapter 2 and verse 5, and an example of Timothy, another sacrificial man, in verse 19, and finally the example of Epaphroditus in chapter 2 and verse 25. So we can have joy in the struggles of life. We will experience joy in the sacrificial life. And thirdly, there is also joy in the self-effacing life. The self-effacing life. You say, what do you mean by that? Simply this. You will not find joy if you are focused on your afflictions or your accomplishments, which most of us are. Joy eludes us because we're looking at afflictions or accomplishments. Paul says joy is not found in those areas. It's found in an admiration and adoration for the person of Christ. I want you to see that. Look at chapter 3 for just a moment, verses 7 and 8. Whatever things were gained to me, that's accomplishment, those things I've counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I have suffered the loss of all things. I count them as rubbish because my joy is in gaining Christ. So it's joy in the self-effacing life. And then finally, in chapter 4, the theme is joy in the satisfied life. In the satisfied life. And you'll see that in chapter 4, verses 11 to 13. Look at those verses with me. Chapter 4, verses 11 to 13. I don't speak from want, for I've learned to be content or satisfied in whatever circumstance I'm in. I know how to get along with humble means and live in prosperity. In any and in every circumstance, I've learned the secret of being filled and being hungry, of having abundance and suffering need. And the secret of joy is I could do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It's joy in the satisfied life. In the sacrificial life, in the satisfied life, in the self-effacing life, in the struggles of life. That's where we're going in the weeks to come. Now, as we step into the text itself, we notice, first of all, in your outline, the writers. Let's take a look at those who wrote the epistle. It begins with these words, Philippians verse 1 of chapter 1. And what's the first word? Paul. I'm sure many memories must have swirled in the minds of those in Philippi when they wrote and read that first word that was penned in that great epistle. You know, 10 years before, the apostle had responded to a Macedonian call by a dream at night in Acts 16:9, called to come over to Europe for the very first time. And he meets a woman named Lydia, a wealthy woman, a seller of purple, leads her to Christ, and then another group of Christians, and they all become the first church, not only in Philippi, but the very first church established on the continent of Europe. So that was God's foothold, as it were, with the gospel in Europe. Now, after a very successful start and a happy beginning, Paul and his companion Silas are falsely accused of being troublemakers, terribly beaten, tossed into prison, but then miraculously freed on the following day, and they made a promise, we will not come back to Philippi and trouble you anymore. Now, it's been 10 long years since Paul had that great experience with the Philippians. They discover that Paul is in Rome, 800 miles removed from them in Philippi, and he has a financial need. So they take one of the chief leaders of the church, a man named Epaphroditus, and they send a care package to Paul by foot. He travels all the way to Rome. When Epaphroditus comes back to Philippi, guess what he brings with him? The letter that's sitting on your lap today. The book of Philippians comes to them by means of Paul through this gentleman. The second author, the second name is Timothy. The Greek word is Timotheos. Theos is God, and time is to honor. It's a man who honored God. And he was Paul's greatest and closest apostle, as we'll see in the weeks to come. Now, what's interesting is that these two writers describe themselves in verse 1 as bond servants of Christ Jesus. We're not Hollywood celebrities. We're not hotshot apostles. We're not sports heroes splashing on the page of newspapers today. We're just common ordinary servants of an uncommon, extraordinary God. That's how they begin the epistle. And so we have seen the writers, now we're addressed to the readers. And that's our second point, as you notice, verse 2. Verse 1 actually says, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, including the overseers and deacons, and then to you, grace and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice what Paul calls them. He doesn't call them sinners. He doesn't call them brothers. He doesn't call them members of the fellowship. The name for Christians biblically is the name saints. You are a saint. The Catholic Church has said a saint is someone who has performed several miracles and is different from the average believer. That's not true. That's not true at all. A saint is an average, ordinary believer who's become extraordinary by the fact that Christ sets them apart from ministry and service. And here's what I find interesting. The vast number of times you see the word saint in the Bible, it's not singular. It's plural, which tells me God never designed you and me to function outside of church. We need community. We discovered last week that we are like the Trinity. God wants us to be connected. He wants us to be hooked into a family, to a fellowship, to a church. That's why the word saint is plural. Dwight Lyman Moody in the late 1800s was a famous preacher in Chicago. And at one point, he visited a fellow clergyman. He said, you know, Pastor Moody, you have a great message from God, and I'd love to have you address our congregation at some point, but I think it would be a bit embarrassing. And Moody said, why? He said, because my church has a bad habit of walking out before the end of the sermon, no matter who the messenger may be. Moody said, well, why don't you let me come and speak? I think I could hold them all the way to the end. He said, okay. So when Moody mounted the pulpit, he looked at the congregation and said, the first half of this sermon is going to be directed to all the sinners in the church. And the second half will be to all the saints. Everyone stayed to the end, miraculously. Now, you were a sinner, you are now a saint, so guess what? You could stay to the end. You don't have to walk out as well. Now, notice in verse 1, it's written to first the overseers. That's one of the words to describe the elders or the spiritual leaders in the church. Episkopeo is the Greek word. Scope, like not mouthwash, but to scope out. And epi is over. Those who oversee the spiritual needs of the congregation and the direction the church is going. The second group, like we have here, are the deacons, those who take care of the physical affairs of the church. So they're all swept into this. And then verse 2 says, I'm praying for grace and peace. Interesting, the world today has pulled back the same emblem or picture that it promoted in the 60s, and that is, peace out, bro. And people are always asking for world peace. God makes it clear there could never be peace in any person's heart until you first experience the grace of God through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. God never switches those two around. Only when you have the Son of God residing in your heart can you experience the satisfaction and joy and peace that God wants to offer you in your soul. And so if that peace does not reign in your heart, it is reasonable to ask yourself, did I honestly and authentically make a full commitment to the Lordship of Christ in my life? Grace first and then peace. Well, we have seen the writers and we have met the readers, and so naturally, we're going to look at point 3, and that is the reasons for the writing. And there are 3 reasons for the writing. First, Paul says, I'm writing to remind them of their friendship. writing to remind them of their friendship. Notice verse 3. I thank my God in all my remembrance of you. That's a great way to start, isn't it? The word for thank is the Greek word eucharisteo. Now, from eucharisteo, we get a liturgical term, and that is the Eucharist. What is the Eucharist? Yes, it is the communion, exactly. And the point of communion service, which we experienced last week, is a time to thank God for the death of Jesus Christ. That's what it means to have communion. It's a time of thanksgiving. It's a gift of grace, the communion. Paul takes that term and applies it to the believers. He said, you are like God's communion table to me. You are God's gift of grace. And every time the name Philippians crosses my mind, a smile graces my face. You thrill me. You inspire me. I thank God for every one of you who lives in the hamlet of Philippi. Now, when you read the epistles of Paul, you will see that he thanked God for the Romans. He thanked God for the Colossians and Thessalonians for three issues: their faith, hope, and love. You could find that in the opening words of those epistles. When Paul writes to the Corinthians, the only reason he could thank God for them, chapter 1 and verse 7, is that you've received all spiritual gifts. That's it. Nothing else. Because by the time he reaches verse 10, he's already talking about divisions and divisiveness and tension in the church. It was a very unhealthy congregation. Sadly, when he writes to the Galatians, he has, catch this, absolutely no word of thanks for them. Nothing. All he says in chapter 1 and verse 6, I am amazed that you have leaped into the pit of legalism so fast. Galatians is Paul's angry letter, but Philippians is a happy letter. He's thrilled. His spirits are lifted. And it says there, I'm always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer. And notice that he was a Southerner, for you all. Always offering prayer with joy in my every prayer. That church gave Paul a happy heart. Reminds me of the words, of the lyrics to the song that was sung by Blood, Sweat, and Tears in the 70s. You make me so very happy. I'm so glad you came into my heart. He is thrilled. He's singing to God because the Philippians give him incredible joy. Notice the words in verse 4. Every and all, every and all, without exception, Paul played no favorites. Little Freddie was telling his mother about his new teacher. He says, she's mean, Mommy, but she's fair. She says, well, how so? Freddie said, she's mean to everybody. Well, Paul is kind, and he's fair, and he's kind to everybody. Even to a couple of ladies in the church who couldn't get along. Imagine that happening. Wow. Yeah, right. We'll meet them in chapter 4. He loved all of them as well. In verse 5, in view of your participation in the gospel from the first day until now. This is why I thank God for you. The word participation is normally translated as fellowship in the New Testament. It's a word you've heard mentioned before by ministers. It's the term koinonia. The New Testament Greek that we studied in seminary was koine Greek, meaning common street language Greek, not classical Greek, but the Bible was written so that every person, even a child, could understand it. We have the words community and communion that come from this. The idea of fellowship is having something in common. If you have children who are engaged in youth sports, they have a koinonia with other kids in the same team. Every week I go surfing with usually a couple of guys from the church. We have a koinonia when it comes to that activity of surfing. as Christians on Sunday, we have something in common. Actually, it is someone in common. Who's that? Jesus Christ. He is the common part. But the Philippians took it a step further than the average church would have with an apostle. He said, "You have been sharing with me from the first day until now." They cooperated with Paul in getting the message out throughout the entire section of Philippi. Paul had to be removed from that town due to persecution. The Philippians picked up the torch and kept taking the gospel to others around them. Secondly, they also, in verse 7, expressed their sympathy with Paul in his afflictions for the gospel. When he hurt, they hurt. That's a koinonia. On top of that, number 3, Philippians 4:14, they sent them financial contributions when he was physically and financially afflicted. But beyond all of that, they were willing to take the love that God has given them and move their finances out of Philippi to reach those who were hurting in other territories, such as in Jerusalem. For Paul writes in Romans 15:26, "For Macedonia," and that's Philippians, "have been pleased to contribute to the poor saints in Jerusalem." I want you to see that as you hold your finger in Philippians. Turn back now to 2 Corinthians in your Bible. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. "So I thought it necessary to urge the brothers that they would go ahead to you and arrange beforehand what you previously promised, a bountiful gift, so that the same would be ready as a bountiful gift and not affected by covetousness." Here's the point. A year before the Corinthians, a wealthy church had promised, "We will contribute to the hurting saints who are suffering in the city of Jerusalem." But the Corinthians, as carnal as they were, conveniently forgot about the promise and refused to come up with the cash. Sign in a psychiatrist's office read, "Amnesia patients must pay in advance." The Corinthians had spiritual amnesia. They had forgotten the promise, but not the Philippians. Now turn back a page to 2 Corinthians 8. 2 Corinthians 8, and notice how Paul describes the Philippians. Verses 1 to 4. "Oh, now, brothers, we wish to make known to you the grace of God which has been given to the churches of Macedonia." And one of the key churches of Macedonia was Philippi. "That in a great ordeal of affliction, their abundance of joy," there's that word, "and their deep poverty overflowed in the wealth of their liberality," their giving. "For I testify that according to their ability, and even beyond their ability, they gave of their own accord, begging us with much urging for the favor of the participation in the support of the saints." Paul said, "You're too weak, you're too poor, you can't afford to give." And they begged us and said, "No, Paul, we want to give. We want to give to the cause of the gospel." And that's why Paul said in Philippians 1 and verse 5, "From the first day until now, 10 days later, everything I hear that comes out of Philippi is good, good, good." All of his memories were great. I mean, when he lands in Philippi, he meets this lady and leads her to the Lord, and she's wealthy, and she has a big house, and she says, "Paul, mi casa is su casa. My house is your house. Let's start a church right here." And people start responding to the gift of grace. And then when Paul casts a demon out of a young girl, she loses her supernatural evil ability to foretell the future. So consequently, the owners of this girl get angry, and they have Paul and Silas put in prison. Their backs are beaten. They're laid open. Their hands are in stocks. But at midnight, instead of whining, instead of moaning, instead of complaining, they are singing praises to God. They turn it into a praise service. And what does God do? And maybe God would do that in your life if you'd sing a little bit more. In fact, if you're not experiencing some great movements of God in your life, it's because you may not be singing. Think about that. Singing does something to the heart of God. You want to get his attention? Open your mouth, use your vocal cords. That's all they did. They just began to sing to the Lord, and guess what God did? He sent an earthquake. An earthquake. And it swung open the prison doors, and they were freed to go, and the jailer, seeing that, assumed that if they got out, he's going to die the next day. He grabbed his sword, got ready to run himself through, and Paul said, "Stop! We're all here." And what did the jailer ask? "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And Paul led that jailer to Christ. The jailer took him home, cleansed their wounds. He led the whole family to the Lord. You see, every memory of the Philippians was a good memory. He only shared a few short moments with them, but they were all precious. This past week, I was driving throughout Tustin, and I came across the street where a family that was close to me used to live in 1970. They were only here for 6 months, but they made an indelible impression on my life. And every time I think of them, I thank God for that short relationship I had with them many decades ago. And that's exactly how Paul is feeling. He says, I write these words to remind you of my love and my care for you. We're all sharing the intensity of the gospel until now. Verse 7. "For it's only right for me to feel this way about you all, because I have you in my heart, since both in my imprisonment and in the defense and the confirmation of the gospel, you were all partakers of grace with me." Now, partakers is the same word again. It's koinonia, but it has a preposition attached to it, so it's intensified. He says we have an intensified connection of love and kindness and grace. Paul says, "I have you in my heart." Someone has observed that many people would have to confess, "I have you on my nerves." But not Paul. Paul said, "You're deep in my heart." And I find it interesting that the grammatical structure of these words in verse 7 make it impossible in the Greek language to tell whether Paul is saying, "I have you in my heart," or that he's saying, "You have me in your heart." And the Spirit of God purposely leaves it ambiguous. Why? Because it doesn't make any difference if they're in Paul's heart or Paul is in their heart, because love will always beget love. See, you're struggling with your spouse today, and you're thinking, if they'll just say, "I'm sorry," and they will admit they're wrong, and they'll take the first step, then I will respond. Don't wait for anyone to take the first step. Who cares who started it? You be the man. You be the woman to start it and get it going in the right direction. Because once you get love going, love comes back to you, and you forget all about who caused the failure in the first place. Amen? Love just begets love. But the opposite is true, too. Little boy was being disciplined by his mom, and he got very angry, and he shouted at her. Then he thought, "Oh, boy, now she's really going to get me." So he ran out of the house, over to the hillside, and screamed into the valley, "I hate you! I hate you!" Then he heard the echo coming back, "I hate you! I hate you!" And startled, he ran back to his mother and said, "There's a mean little boy in the valley who keeps shouting he hates me." His mother said, "Well, go back to the hillside and shout, 'I love you! I love you!'" And when he did, miracle of miracles, there was a boy in the valley who loved him too. That's what life's all about. You're critical. You're judgmental. You have impossible standards from you for others around you. And you don't feel connected to people. Guess whose fault that is? It's yours. I hear people, I've had people leave the church before because they say, well, I don't have any friends in that church. I go, really, at Orange Coast? Problem has to be you. This is the friendliest church I know of, I've ever been associated with. The Bible says if you want friends, you got to make yourself friendly. See, you got to get the thing started in the right direction. Love will beget love. What we give is what we get in life. What we give is what we get in life. And so Paul said, I'm giving to you, and you're giving to me. And Paul shouts to the Philippians, I love you. And they shout back with Epaphroditus, we love you too. In verse 8, he says, God is my witness. So he's really putting his hand down now. How I long for you with the affection of Christ Jesus. He's saying, I'll put my hand on the Bible. I will swear to you that I have such a passion for you. I actually have the affection of Jesus in my heart. Now, the word affection is the Greek word splagna. Say, that didn't sound very nice. Well, it's the intestines. It's the internal organs that we don't show the rest of the world. Why? Because in the Greek mindset, that's where you feel affection. Right down here in the gut. You don't feel it here. You feel it here. I mentioned that months ago when I sent my daughters off in the year 2000, one to New York and the other to Hawaii. It didn't break my head, it broke my heart. If you've lost a loved one, a parent, a spouse, a child to death, this is where you get it, right here. If you fall in love with an individual and you are so thrilled about this brand new, refreshing relationship, and they suddenly and tragically break it off, it breaks your heart. The affections are right here. Paul said, I'm feeling in my heart that I can't be connected with you. His heart is broken. He says, I'm 800 miles removed from Philippi, and I can't get to you right now. This past week, I talked to one of my daughters living many miles away, and she was going through some heartbreaking times in her life. And she began to cry, oh, Dad, my heart is so broken. And it hurt me because I was thousands of miles removed from where she's at. I said, honey, I wish I could just hold you in my arms right now. But I couldn't do that. And that's how Paul is feeling. That's why he says, as God is my witness, my heart is broken because I can't be with my favorite people on planet Earth. So you see, all the words that he selects to say, I want to remind you of our friendship that we've shared together. Secondly, because they were so close, he writes to reassure them of their future. To reassure them of their future. And here we come across one of the classic verses of Scripture that was put to song, the first song we sang today. Many of you have it memorized. For I am confident, verse 6, of this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day of Christ Jesus. When it comes to salvation, God commences it, God continues it, God completes it. Say that with me. When it comes to salvation, God commences it, God continues it, God completes it. God is the one who is the power behind it. Now, I've known Christians throughout the years who are familiar with the verses on eternal security. Christians who have memorized Philippians 1:6. Christians who are aware of John chapter 10, 28 to 29, where Jesus said, you are in my hands and you are in the Father's hand and you have double protection throughout all eternity. Christians who are fully aware of a verse that we sang today from Romans 8, 38 to 39, who can separate us from the love of God? Nothing, nobody. And they have all those words in their head, but they don't have the reassurance in their heart. They're still wondering, am I really saved? Can I know for certain God's going to get me to heaven? Why do people ask that question? Their eternal security is based on the insecurity of people who promised to love them but left them. And so they're thinking that's what God's going to do someday, because he's just like everyone else I've met in my life. Due to a lack of character, some people are fickle. They are fickle and undependable. There are Christians who leave churches for the worst reasons imaginable. There are spouses who walk away from their marriage partner for the stupidest reasons you could ever begin to think about. And there are parents who are so selfish that they walk away from a relationship with their little children. Happens all the time. And when a person goes through this again and again and again in life, they begin to believe God will also leave them in the lurch. I know God. He's going to get fed up with my failures. He's going to get sick and tired of my sins. And he's going to walk away from me like everyone on earth has left me and walked away from me. And I'm here as your pastor today to tell you, he won't. In fact, better than that, he can't. It's outside of his character. He's the one who commenced it, who keeps it going, and will continue it all the way to the end. Isn't that great to know? And so when you're struggling to stay with it, but you just keep coming every Sunday to church, you keep picking up your Bible and reading every morning, you keep spending time in prayer each day, remember who's prodding you to do that. Who's leading you? Who's taking you down the path that goes to glory? It's God. It's his Spirit. He's the one who's making it happen. He's the one who's overcoming any difficulties in your life. And he promises in this verse to propel you from the starting point of salvation to the finishing point of glorification. Richard Mylander writes, "On my way to a conference in Colorado, I was driving uphill along a major interstate when I overtook a freight train going in the same direction at a slower speed. The train was being pushed uphill by two locomotives that sounded like they were straining at full power. Now, I'm a flatlander from the Midwest. Is this how trains move in mountainous terrain?" I asked myself. But a few minutes later, I gradually came alongside the front of the nearly mile-long string of cars, and I found five locomotives pulling the train, seven engines in all. That train was a lesson for me. I've been under serious strain for a long time. I was feeling wiped out. I was wondering, could I preserve and persevere under this pressure? How like God, I thought, when I'm pushing a load uphill and feel like my energy is depleted, he wants me to know he's pulling from the opposite side with five locomotives with a lot more strength than I could ever muster up. So every time you're putting that foot forward, saying, I don't want to go to church, but I will do it. I don't want to share my faith, but I will share it. I don't want to be kind to the one who's been cruel to me, but I will be kind. The Spirit of God is the one in front, and he's just pulling you right along. He's pulling you right along. So always remember that he who began the good work will be faithful to complete it. And by the way, if you have not yet memorized that verse, that's my homework assignment for you, to jot it down in a stick-em or wherever you want, and say it again and again and again, so by the time next week comes around, you will have that verse permanently embedded in your memory. Paul writes to remind them of their friendship. Paul writes to reassure them of their future. And thirdly, Paul writes to revitalize their fine lives. To revitalize their fine lives. See, Paul said you're doing great, but I want you to do better. I want to give you a shot of vitality. And as we enter into this one section of vitality, here's what's going to apply to you and me. Here's the way we could test ourselves to see if we're growing into the image of Jesus Christ today. Watch the words that Paul shares with us, beginning in verse 9. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound still more and more. Your love is good. Your love is fine. I want to give a shot in the arm. I want more vitality when it comes to your love. You say, what do you mean? Giving more love to the people I'm already nuts about? No. You're fine in that area. More love to the people you don't like at all. That's what Paul's praying for. That's what the Spirit of God's trying to accomplish in your life and mine. One man said, to love the whole world for me is no chore. My problem is the guy next door. I love humanity, Charlie Brown said. It's people that I can't stand. Yes. You ask yourself, am I growing in Christ? Here's a way to test it. Am I learning to love the unlovable person that I don't like in this church, in my family, in the place in which I've employed? That's what God's calling me and you to do. To step up our love, to intensify our love. People we don't prefer spending time with, we start treating them nicely and decently. We don't sit as far as we can away from them on a Sunday morning. That's right. We need to be civil and decent and kind. That's a test of Christian maturity. Amen. Are you loving the unlovable? And then he says in verse 9, I'm also praying that you will abound in real knowledge and all discernment. Now, there's a Greek word for knowledge, oida, which speaks of the intellectual, absolute knowledge. This word is gnosko, which speaks of an experiential knowledge. And it has a preposition attached to it, which intensifies it. And so what is he saying? I am asking you to reach that point in your life when you have this deepened, intensified personal knowledge that you are God's special preferred child and he has a plan for your life. How do you get to that place in your life? And why do some Christians struggle with the sense that God doesn't love them? Sometimes because they're not reaching out in love to others. Sometimes because they're not in church on Sundays. Sometimes because they're choosing not to get engaged or involved in a ministry. They're not giving love, so they're not getting love. But as your love begins to abound, then the experience and knowledge of God's love for you becomes more sound in your soul. And you don't doubt your eternal security. You don't wonder, am I going to get to glory? You are secure and safe in your relationship with the Savior. And on top of that knowledge, I'm also praying for what in verse 9? All discernment. The word discernment means to catch on. It means to comprehend. It means it finally clicks. You get it. It's the ability to tell right from wrong. There are people in the church, in our church, and in every church who have the spiritual gift of discernment. They could look at a person and say, that person's bad news. That person is safe. How do they know that? The Spirit of God gives them that ability. Now, you and I may not have that spiritual gift, but as we begin to walk with Christ, as we begin to love people we don't like, and begin to get the security of Christ's salvation that never is questioned in our hearts, along with all that comes an ability to discern. Right from wrong, truth from error. You know, that's one of the true signs of maturity, isn't it? Discernment, the ability to distinguish. Little baby, little boy or girl, when they speak for the first time, they may call every four-legged animal bow-wow, bow-wow, bow-wow. They get a little older, they realize, wait a second, they're white mice. They're Siamese cats. They're Doberman pincers. They're different kinds of animals. Put a child who's a year and a half old in the backyard with a basketball, with a football, with a soccer ball. Can he tell the difference? No! They're just balls to him. But as he gets older, he learns these balls are different. One is to be passed, one is to be kicked, one is to be dunked, if you're tall enough. Everyone has a different purpose and a different design in mind. And so it is in the Christian life. We learn to develop what is important and what is irrelevant, what is good and bad, and distinguishing between the better and the very best in life. That's a sign of Christian maturity. And in verse 10, I'm praying this in order that you may approve the things that are excellent, in order to become sincere and blameless until the day of Christ Jesus. Approve means to test. It was used of a saying a coin or a medal. It was used of a standing candidate for the doctor of medicine who has passed all of his exams. You could test people. You could test situations out. It means you're no longer gullible. You know why the cults grow today? The cults do not grow because they are reaching people outside of Christ. The Mormons, the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Christian Scientists, the cults grow because they steal people from evangelical churches by knocking on their doors. Dumb people, ignorant people who may be ignorant because their pastor is not teaching them the Word of God. You come here Sunday after Sunday after Sunday, you'll never be duped by the teachings of the cult. I promise to teach you the truth so when you hear what is error, you'll be able to distinguish between the two. That's the point of maturity. God wants that distinguishment. He wants us to be able to prove what is good. And then he says, interestingly, in verse 10, I want you to be sincere and blameless. Let's talk about those two terms. The Greek word sincere is made up of two separate words, which means, watch this, to be tested by the light of the sun. To be tested by the light of the sun. And here's the point he's saying. As you find yourself growing in Christ, you permit the truth of God's light to penetrate the inner recesses of your soul. Not the weaknesses and the character flaws that your wife or your husband see. Not the character weaknesses that everyone in the church knows about, but the ones that only you know about. The secret sins, the quiet places, the issues of guilt and sadness, of constant bad behavior that controls your life. As you grow, you say, Lord, let the sun shine in. And the light of God's love begins to penetrate those places. And here you are. You are now mature enough where you don't have to pretend anymore. You don't have to play act Christianity. You don't have to look like you have it together when you don't. And you reach that great location of one of my all-time favorite verses, James 5:16, confessing your sins one to another. That's reciprocal in the Greek. One to another, and praying for one another, watch this, so that you may be healed. Physical, emotional, spiritual healing come when you and I are honest about who we really are in life. And if you're finding yourself reaching that level of honesty, hats off to you. It means you are becoming a mature man or woman in Christ. You say, it doesn't make any sense because I'm talking about my sins. I'm talking about my failures. God can't use me because I'm not perfect. God doesn't use perfect people because there are no perfect people. He used flawed, forgiven sinners, people who are willing to admit that they're flawed. God wants to work in their life. We know that because 2 Corinthians 4:7 says, we have this treasure. Here's God's treasure in earthen vessels. The Greek says clay pots. God puts all this power in the clay pot of my life so that the power of God may be seen in him and not in me. He doesn't want you to be magnified. He doesn't want you to be glorified. He will one day when you die, but not now. He wants to be glorified. And in the meantime, he does that by you talking about your sins and your failures and your weaknesses and shortcomings and not trying to cover them up with little games and little jokes and little pretend activities of play acting. Maturity says, here's where I really am, and I need your prayer. And God says, I'm going to use you because of that honesty in your life. And then he prays, I want you to be blameless. Blameless, you mean perfect without blame? That's not what that means. The Greek says, not stumbled against. Not stumbled against. So what does that mean? Well, some of us choose not to smile. And people around us are always sad when they see us. And they stumble because of the way we come across. Some of us, and I can be like this at times, walk into a room, walk into a Bible study, walk into a group of people, and we're like a bull in a china shop. We just barge right in, and when we're done, we just bolt right out, and we say, well, I don't care what people think. This is the way I am. That's not the way you are. That's the way Satan made you. God doesn't make junk. That's not your personality. That's sin. And you and I need to get to the point, if we're maturing, where we ask ourselves, what am I saying? What am I doing that's hurting the testimony of Christ in my life? Don't let people stumble at you. Be a point that encourages those to become more like Christ. That's what it means to be blameless. In verse 11, having been filled with the fruit of righteousness, which comes through Christ Jesus to the glory and the praise of God, and the fruit of righteousness is based on the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5:22. You know it. It's love and joy and peace and patience, kindness, gentleness, goodness, faithfulness, self-control. These are all various terms to describe a person who is a lover by nature. The Philippians love Paul. Paul loved the Philippians. And he's asking them to love even more. And that's what God's asking from us as Christians in the hamlet of Orange to develop today. He wants us to have a sense of kindness and compassion that will touch the lives of others in an extraordinary way. David Ireland was dying of a crippling neurological disease. And so he wrote a series of letters that was put in a book to a little infant who was resting in his wife's womb. Little baby boy or girl whom he knew he would never see. And he wanted that little one to know how much mommy loved daddy. Here's what he writes. Your mother is very special. Few men know what it's like to receive appreciation for taking their wives out to dinner, what it entails, what it does for us. It means that your mom has to dress me, shave me, brush my teeth, comb my hair, wheel me out of the house, down the steps, open the garage, put me in the car, take the pedals off the chair, stand me up, sit me in the seat of the car, twist me around so I'm comfortable, fold the wheelchair, put it back in the car, go around to the opposite side of the car, start it up, back it out, get out of the car, pull the garage door down, get back into the car, and then drive to the restaurant. Then it starts all over again. Your mom gets out of the car, unfolds the wheelchair, opens the door, spins me around, stands me up, seats me in the wheelchair, pushes the pedals out, closes and locks the car, wheels me to the restaurant, takes the pedals off the wheelchair so I won't be uncomfortable. We sit down to dinner, and she feeds me for the whole dinner. When it's all over, your mom pays the bill, pushes the wheelchair out to the car, and reverses the routine. And then, honey, when it's all over, when it's completely finished, she looks into my eyes and says with real warmth, "Sweetheart, thank you so much for taking me out to dinner tonight." And I never know what to say. Let's bow our heads together. Here's a second homework assignment. Has someone touched your life with tenderness? Why don't you do what Paul did? Tell them thanks this week through a phone call, through a handwritten letter, or a face-to-face encounter. Why not make it a point for the next 7 days, every day now, to lift that person to God's throne of grace and prayer and to ask the Lord to bless them in a big way this week. You know, God touched your heart with tenderness when he took his only begotten son and nailed him to a cross. That cross was given to cleanse you from all sin. There's one simple way to tell him thanks. He wants your heart. He asks for your life today. It's possible that the Spirit of God's touched you and he's spoken to you and he has said, it's time to make a decision to make Christ Savior and Lord of your life. And you want to do that right now. Seated there, everything can change for the future if you will change today by releasing your heart and life to Jesus Christ. You say, Pastor, that's what I want to do. And so I'm going to ask you just to lift your head and you catch me in the eyes as I'll be looking across the congregation. When I see you, those eyes looking into mine will say, Pastor, would you pray for me right now that I could make a decision to give my life to Christ? If that's your desire, you could look at me right now. God bless you, my friend. God bless you. If you would just pray this prayer with me, God will perform a miracle in your heart right now. Dear Father in heaven, I realize that I have failed you in many ways. I'm flawed and imperfect. But you sent your son as the perfect sacrifice for my sin. I accept him as my Savior and Lord right now. I release my life into your capable hands. Thanks for forgiving my sin. Thanks for giving me a home in heaven. And I will walk with you each day. I love you, Father. Thank you for the gift of Jesus. In his name I pray. Amen.